it's Jeffrey with Real Nifty Vintage, and today I thought I would give you a little bit of a backstory of how I came into reselling. So this is going to be more of an informal chit chat, and I actually had to write down notes because I, for the life of me, could not remember how I even got to where I am. Not that it's an overly impressive story or anything, it's just that for some reason I was having issues recalling some things. So luckily the internet's a great way to remember that. So the first actual time that I had any idea that you could resell things that you bought was at an auction. And my very first auction was almost by a mistake. You know, I wasn't planning on going. I had no idea what was to even be there. But what happened was Aaron's grandma actually passed away in, well, it was 2013 at some point. I don't know exactly the, it was, you know, probably towards the end of the 2013, but there was an auction, an estate auction. And so November 2013, my job at that auction, because we were together, so I came just as sort of, nobody knew me. You know, I was still living in another town with Aaron, and we had a house over there, but this was in, now where we live, in this town. So we were here, no one knew who I was, so my job at this auction was to bid the price up, because Aaron's dad wanted certain prices for specific things. One of them was a Victrola, which we now have because it didn't go for as much as they wanted. There was a couple quilts. I think there was like some old tin toys. So there was different things that his dad specifically wanted me to make sure got a certain amount. And if they didn't, he wanted just to keep them. So that was what I did. So I got my first job of bidding and I found it very fun. So while I was there, however, I saw many things going cheaper than I thought was fair, the fair market value. So there was, in particular, there was a couple glass canisters. They were like an iridescent, I'm trying to remember, they had like a scroll work on them, some filigree. I'll insert a photo if I can find it. And they went for like $2 or $3. I was like thinking those are worth at least 20 or 30. And so I bid, and I did that multiple times, see? And I got some glasses and lots of different things from this auction. But I got it home, you know, a big box full of stuff in my other house before this one. And I was like, what am I doing with all this stuff? So like the glasses we used, and we still do, however, they're old and they break every now and again. So I'm down to 4 out of the original 6. But, oopsie. But anyways, there was a lot of stuff there that I was able to buy because the price was right. So it wasn't until about 2015, like a whole year and a half later, so a while, that we were moved into this house and we were settled in, and there was an auction going on across the street with one of those auction house companies where they come to your house and they have it in the yard, you know, they have everything on tables. So we figured, me and Barb, Aaron's sister, we thought we'd go over and take a look. And once again, I was seeing prices that were just cheaper than they should have. Now, of course, there's obviously things that were going for high prices, but there was value in things that were being sold that no one was seeing. At least I figured, because there was they were going for $1, $2, and they were worth $20, $30. So I was bidding once again. However, I didn't have a store. I didn't have an online. I was just seeing this. So now this is where my thinking gets a little fuzzy, because I don't remember exactly how everything went down. But so that was like mid 2015. It wasn't until, well, August 28th, 2016 that I opened my Etsy shop. And I opened it only because I had like 15, 20 things laying around the house that I was like, what am I doing with this stuff? And I was like, I don't want to throw these things away. I don't want to donate them. I want the money for them because I know they're worth more. I was a shopper on Etsy. I saw the prices that were out there, and I said to myself, I can do that. I can sell these things. So I did a lot of research. I invested the time into looking at how to photograph items. I had a light box that I made myself out of a big cardboard box, and it took really good photos. But so I did that for a while. And it wasn't, I think, I listed something and then maybe a day, 2 days later, that item sold. Or one of the first, very first items sold. That got me hooked very early. I was like, are you kidding? It's this easy. I can list something and it sells. Now, mind you, I was making sure that my tags were good, my title was good, my photos were good, and my description was good. So I know there's a lot of you out there that are starting Etsy stores and you're like, I can't get a sale at all. And I don't know what to say about that. I just do everything that I can. I make sure the item itself is something that I think will sell. And it has a lot to do with that. I mean, I think at the end of the day, if the items are not popular or kind of at the ebb and flow of what's relevant right now, you might have a problem and it might be harder to sell it. But I was able to see right off the bat that this could be something. So I listed a few things. I saw the growth of that. And for the very first months, like 4 or 5 months, I didn't have more than 50 items on my store. And it wasn't really, you know, a full-fledged business by any means. I was working still at a graphic design company, and I was driving 45 minutes a day there and then back. I did not like it. I've been in the graphic design business since right out of college. That was what I went to school for. That's always what I thought I was going to be happy with doing, because that was a skill that I learned in high school. And I really just fell in love with the idea of creating things and all that. So I continued that. But I will say that throughout all this time, I always had a love for vintage things, old things. And I remember my first house, I had a toaster, a chrome toaster, which is one of the items that I sold originally in my store. And I would put like mail in the toaster, didn't use it. I would just put it on a table and then put my my mail as like a sorting station. So it was kind of funny. And then I had an old Bakelite radio. I had a Van Briggle vase that someone gave me at a flea market that I went to. It was broke and glued back together, but I thought it was cool. And there was just all these like little things all over the house that were vintage. And I had them just kind of in weird uses, because what are you gonna do with, you know, a chrome toaster that you're scared to use? So there was all these things. I've long been interested in that, the older stuff. So I got sidetracked. So by the later part of 2016, I had my store and I was thinking, gosh, you know, if I can do this, I just need to buy more vintage things and repeat it. It's like buy and sell. And so I was thinking, well, how can I find more stuff? And then I looked onto auctionzip.com, found out that there was auctions nearby that I could get to still with while I was working. And so I made it a habit out of, I think it was every Friday night. It could be every other Friday night. I don't remember for sure, but I think it was maybe every other Friday night. There was an auction so whenever I got off work, I drove home, and on my way home, this auction was happening. And so I stopped in and I would, you know, buy $20, $30 worth of stuff that were all $2, $3 here and there, and then list them on my shop. And so I was buying pretty much anything and everything at that point, because everything was new to me and it was so exciting. So that was one way that I was sourcing early on. And then I was also, when I could, go to this Thursday night auction that was in a slightly larger town, and it was more popular. And so I was going to that one. And then of course I was going to Saturday and Sunday auctions whenever I could. So I was really trying to go to as many sourcing opportunities as I could very early on. And I was also going to Savers and occasionally Goodwill. But I more so now I find myself going to these thrift stores than even to begin with. I was really entranced by the auction mentality at the start of reselling. And I think it's kind of weird, because a lot of you think, oh, how could you possibly buy things at auctions? Things go so high. Well, the trick is finding the things that are not going high, and not everything goes high. It's just that you have to know what to buy that people are not really thinking about, because people, you can't be an expert in everything. You really can't. So this was maybe at the beginning of the whole mid-century thing. And now I see around here that mid-century has really taken off. So now I'm already thinking about the next things that I want to start focusing on. And for me, there's lots of avenues to go through, but so I'm not going to get into that, but that's really what started with the auctions and everything. I actually got my first antique booth while I was still working full-time at the t-shirt print shop. I was doing graphic design work in a print shop for a t-shirt company. And so I was doing screen print design layouts and all this. And it was I don't know how much I want to go into that, but the job itself was very dead, deadening. I didn't feel like I was really using my full potential. I frequently found myself looking out the window, hoping and wishing I could just drive away in the middle of the day. And I think that's a pretty common sentiment. But there was just so much that I felt restricted of. You know, I had listened to Brass Armadillo with Gary Stover. That he does YouTube videos, and that's with the Denver, Colorado Brass Armadillo, I think it is. And I was watching their videos, or listening to mostly because I'm at work. I was watching Vintage Vinny. I'll link him below. I was watching his thrift hauls and stuff. I was watching the Pudgy Picker, which again, it's kind of like left field. It's not even really, she doesn't source a lot of vintage, but what I was really gaining with her, I guess, was that, wow, I find these things interesting. You know, even if I don't necessarily see myself buying exactly what she's buying, I get excited in the interaction of she's excited, okay? So all these thoughts are running through. I'm like, you know, maybe one day I could do that too. I could do videos like this. But I'm like, oh, I'm too shy. I can't do stuff like that. And I am. I don't really put myself out there. But all these ideas rushing through. I'm like, wow, what an amazing idea that would be to do this. So I had my first antique booth and I stocked it up. It was really great and it went off really well. I was making $200-$400 a month just in the booth. There goes the clock. And I liked it so much that I actually, well, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I did end up quitting my job at the t-shirt company by April. By April of 2017, I was just not in it at all. My head wasn't in it. My heart wasn't in it. I just did not want to be there at all. I saw the potential of reselling. I said to myself, look, if I'm spending my Saturday and my Sunday and the occasional nightly time I get on Fridays, Thursdays to go to these sales, what would happen if I actually just quit cold turkey and dove 100% and was able to use all of my days as a reseller? And so that was the idea. I saw how much I was making and I said, I could probably double that easily if I just obviously worked double the amount of time in it. By the middle of 2017, I decided that I was actually ready for another booth. And the reason why I even got an antique booth was because of these auctions. And I was going to these auctions and coming home with boxes of things. And Aaron can probably remember the early times and he didn't know what he was getting himself into. And I don't think I did either. I would come home from these auctions Friday nights. I wouldn't get home till about 10 o'clock at night. And I would come in with these boxes, 4, 5, 6 boxes full of stuff. And fill the whole countertop with them. And I was like, what am I going to do with all this stuff? Like, there's only a couple things here that I wanted to list, and the rest of this, I'm like, yeah, this is like worth $4. This is worth maybe $7. And yes, I will admit early on, I was putting a lot of things online that were like $8 with shipping or plus shipping and $6 plus shipping. Or even I think I went as low as like $2 plus shipping. I can't explain why. It's just the novelty and the newness of it all that I felt that I wanted to do that. But I still had lots of stuff around the house. And I realized I have to have another avenue to get rid of this other stuff. And I don't want to just donate it. I don't want to throw it away. I want to capitalize on this stuff because it's in my possession now. And I see the value. There is value still in this stuff. So I stumbled into an antique mall that I've never been to, never even heard of. And I can't remember exactly how I learned about it. I think Aaron might have heard about it from someone and then he said we should go check it out. So we did. I believe it was the first time we went to the antique mall. I walked in, I looked around, I said, this is nice, this is good. Not the best antique mall. I don't want to put the owner under the bus, but it's not the best I've ever been to. But it was cozy, I liked the atmosphere, and I quickly found that this is actually a good fit for me. So I found the owner of the antique mall and I said, I just asked a few questions, you know, how much is a booth here? I might have asked, how long have you been around doing this? They were only at the time, I think, in it for maybe the second or third year of that antique mall there. And so I don't know if that was that day or not, but it seems pretty, in my head, everything kind of goes jumbled together, even though I'm now looking at my timeline and it stems all the way back to 2013. I had no clue. I thought this was all within 2 years, but here we are. So it seems to me that I said, I'd like a booth. At first I started with a bookcase, and a bookcase was only about the size of a bookcase. You know, what is that? About two, 3 feet wide and 7, 8 feet tall. And I brought like 3 tote fulls of stuff. to fill my bookcase. I got in there, I put my things on the shelf. I said, this is nice. I looked down. I didn't even unpack all my boxes. I still had stuff. And I knew I still have stuff at home, waiting. I said, well, I'll put all this stuff on the shelf. It'll sell in a week. Come back and put the rest. No. But I did sell stuff in the booth, and it did, or in the bookcase. And I said, right away, within 2 weeks, I need a booth. So I told her I need a booth. And luckily she had one waiting. So I filled that up and I had booth number one ready to go. But that was, like I say, I'm kind of woo all over the place, but that was before I quit my job. And it was a great time. But I did get my second booth in, like I say, in the July of 2017. And that was just because of necessity. I had done as much as I could putting all the items I had in the first booth, and I still had leftover stuff. And so naturally you want to expand. So I did. Not a lot to say about that. All the while, I'm sourcing and buying displays and shelves and stuff to use in the booth. Of course, you need places to put things, so that all goes with it. It was not until November of 2017, November 29th, I posted my very first YouTube video. And that is kind of where we are, and you can kind of follow me throughout from then. But that is basically my story of reselling, how it was sort of an accident. I just happened into it. I had no clue that reselling, I know it sounds dumb, I know it sounds like I am making this up, but I had no clue that this was a viable business. I mean, I've been to antique stores. I just never thought about it. I never thought about, who are these people that are doing this? How are they sourcing this stuff? Where are they getting the stuff? How does this all work? I never thought about it. Even though high school, 17, 18, I was going to the flea market basically every weekend. Well, I was every weekend. And, you know, so I mean, I'm just saying, who would have thought? And I guess what I'm saying, it's amazing how life works that way, how you never know where you're going to end up. You really don't. And I don't know where I'm going. So let's put it that out there, that just because I'm here where I am and you're watching me, you think that I've got it figured out. Well, I mean, I've got it figured out up until this point, but it was pretty much by accident. And I'll get to where I'm going in the future, probably by accident, because for the most part, I kind of take life as it comes to me and I just edit what I want to happen, if that makes a whole lot of sense. So it's not that I know my grand plan. I work on that daily, trying to figure out what I want to go, where I want to go in the future. And yeah, it's just sort of a process that I guess we all work through. But I wanted to go ahead and shed some light on this topic, because I think there's probably a lot of questions surrounding how I even got into this and the motivation and all of that. But hopefully I answered broad enough questions that you got a good idea of where I'm coming from. But anyways, thanks for watching, and don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Bye-bye.